Well, hello everyone. How are you, strangers? I'm the stranger because I haven't been here a while. Sorry, it's taken me a few weeks to get back. Just shit show, chaos, clusterfuck. It was a mess. Lots of transitions, lots of moving from here to there, lots of, you know, kind of updates and rearranges. And so that was intense, but I made it through. I'm still making it through. Anyway, how are you guys? I missed sitting here and pontificating about things. And this week I thought I would talk about something that I've touched on in other videos. Some of my favorite movies are now considered problematic. Some of those movies are John Hughes films. I couldn't really find the buttonhole, you know, like the thing to kind of bring it all together. And then I happened to catch Inside View podcast with Michael Rosenbaum, who, if you don't listen to that podcast or don't know who Michael Rosenbaum is, he played Lex Luthor on the series Smallville. He was in a handful of films. I think he's an underrated actor. I think he never quite found his niche because he kind of is all over the place, but he definitely gives a good podcast. So I'll link it below. But anyway, so I wanted to watch that particular episode because he was interviewing Anthony Michael Hall. For those of you who don't know who Anthony Michael Hall, like, that's six syllables. I'm just going to say AMH for the purpose of the video. Those of you who don't know who AMH is, he is an actor. He's been around since kind of early mid 80s, and he's been in tons of projects, most notably collaborations with John Hughes. So he was in Vacation. John Hughes has written tons of films and wrote and directed quite a few. The ones that I'm going to focus on today and the ones that I'm speaking to are his teen comedies. Within the Inside You podcast, AMH just really kind of confirmed and expanded on ideas about John Hughes that I had always suspected, that I always felt to be true about him. And after I watched that and I started thinking about, you know, this video, I decided to get the other main source and the other most prominent actor in his movies, and that's Molly Ringwald. She wrote an article for the New York Times in which she broke down kind of looking back at the Breakfast Club in light of the Me Too movement and all the progress that we've made. So fascinating. I will link that down below as well. Considering that those two are his main collaborators, I would say, besides anyone at a studio or anything like that. After hearing from AMH and then, you know, hearing what Molly Ringwald had to say, at least in that article within the context of what I'm talking about, it all kind of came together and I figured out exactly why I love his movies, exactly why they've endured, and exactly what's wrong with them, and how you can enjoy them anyway. That's what this video is going to be. If that sounds good, stick around. First and foremost, John Hughes to me is a visionary. He's a really cool, really intelligent, really talented writer. Somehow for a middle-aged man, he knows the teenage plight so well that his films have endured. Whether you love them or hate them, they have endured and shaped a generation. Several generations, I would say. If you look back through all the progress that we've made and where we are now, I can see why people rip it apart and are kind of disgusted or maybe curious as to why people love those movies. What the younger generations are missing and what I'm hopefully going to fill in for you today is the world around the movies that were made at that time. For the time that they came out, John Hughes movies were progressive. Yeah, let that sink in for a second. Culture has come an incredibly long way, and in order to make progress, you have to start somewhere and you have to kind of fumble around for a while. And I feel like half of the John Hughes movies is a fumble and the other half is a deep, wise, heartfelt thing. Older generations love to be like, well, you have to understand it was the time. It was a different time and place. And now I'm saying shit like that. But if he had pulled back and were more diplomatic or more wholesome with his jokes, with his character choices, I don't think the art would have endured. Art is neither wholesome nor safe. That's debatable nowadays because when we talk about separating the art from the artist, it gets dodgy because it seems like you're trying to defend someone who is not worthy of being defended. Personally, my rights and my voice as a young person were still under the kids are seen and not heard umbrella. it was changing, but it was still very hush-hush or very on the low, very marginalized for you to be considered a human being with thoughts and feelings of your own. And that translated to everything across the board. So your emotional health, your physical health, your sexuality, anything remotely sexual, like none of it was talked about. And if it was talked about, it was kind of a backhanded, like, oh, you just don't worry about it. Like, you learn about it when you're older, blah, blah, blah. The sex talk I had was, so you know about sex, right? To give you an idea of where we were at. Do your work, shut up, don't question authority, just take it and shut up and grow up and be status quo and die, you know? And for anybody who felt differently about their life, that was so unbelievably stifling. But what were we gonna do? Talk amongst ourselves, but that's rarely enough. Without a whole mass consensus of how things ought to be for children and have an open dialogue with them, like, we were just kind of out there fooling around. You were considered to be upholding the sanctity of your family and of society if you just kept your mouth shut about any kind of negative interaction that you had, anything. You just had to keep it to yourself. It was understood that you just shut your mouth. Things are still that way. You know, that's never going to go away, I don't think, because progress seems like a runaway horse, even though it started a long time ago and now it's just picking up speed. That's when people notice. In that way, I feel like that's how John Hughes kind of started to change things. In the podcast that I referenced, The Inside You, Anthony Michael Hall confirmed that John Hughes was a huge collaborator. He wanted input. He wanted, you know, they played around with stuff. A lot of the best moments in his movies are improvised. To me, that just speaks to him wanting the best for his film, but him also wanting the best for his actors, which is big because back then, in no way was it like it is now, where we're learning about, you know, what's it called, the toddler to train wreck pipeline and like all that stuff. So that he was pioneering and championing for younger actors says a lot about him, I think, and about his intention with his movies. I love John Hughes movies, I'm not gonna lie. My main three were Breakfast Club, Weird Science, and Ferris Bueller's Day Off. Those three were kind of really my jam. 16 Candles and Pretty in Pink, those were kind of like secondary. Like if I couldn't find the first three, I would get the other two. And it's just because the tone of the other two is a little more intense. I think he really hit his stride with the other three. I was thoroughly enriched by all of the choices that he made. Style choices, music choices, costume choices. I mean, all of it was so memorable and so iconic. When I hear someone, you know, a younger generation or whatever, badmouth those movies, it bums me out a little bit. I feel a little hurt. To give you an example, I was in a college class that was like a 101, like radio, history of radio and media, primarily 18 and 19 year old students. And then there's me, like, ugh. We went around the room and we talked about why we were there and what we wanted to get out of the class. And I said, well, I'm a filmmaker and, you know, I love to tell stories. I'm inspired by, you know, John Hughes movies. You could have heard a pin drop. Like, what did she say? Like, at the time, I didn't even realize it until probably the next project we had to do in class, and someone pointed out all of the racial stereotypes, all of the, you know, borderline SA that's portrayed in the movies, that's made light of, and all that stuff. And then I was like, oh, okay, so they're not seeing it through where I was when I saw it the first time. They're seeing it through the where we got to because of it, if that makes sense. So everybody's looking back like, what the fuck, can you believe what we did back then? You know, whereas I was watching it like, oh my God, look what's possible. I didn't realize until then. Like, I get it. I totally get it. In the New York Times article, Molly Ringwald breaks it down really well, really eloquently, really succinctly. And she's just saying like, hey, they're not the best. In no way are they the best. I really wish that John Hughes had been an indie filmmaker, that he had nothing to do with the studios, that they weren't a component that he had to deal with. I feel like they pushed him to be raunchier maybe, or they pushed him to be more racially like bleh. The only reason I say that is because I don't think that he would have had characters in his movies that were pushing against those stereotypes. In that movie, 16 Candles, there's a character called Long Duk Dong, and if you haven't seen the movie, that sounds like just the character name alone, you're like, he is an exchange student from China, And he comes to stay with the grandparents of the main character, and then there's a wedding, so they all get together. So he is exposed to a bunch of American culture all at once. He, you know, speaks with a heavy accent, and there's the sound of a gong every time he's on screen. Yeah, that's that, like, what? Like, I can't even believe we did that shit. And it was okay. Can't believe that shit. At the same time, in order to enact change, in order for there to be a memorable, really well-portrayed character of an ethnicity that isn't normally focused upon, when 16 Candles was made, that was not the case. In order for that, you have to hide that progress in with a bunch of old man, think it's funny jokes. The sound of the gong, the, you know, just the way that he was presented to the audience was very much, that's not okay. However, on the other side of the coin, Long Duk Dong goes the hardest of anyone in the movie. He jumps in with both feet. He's making out with this hot track star chick that's like twice his size and like these huge boobs. From a teenage movie standpoint, like, he strikes gold. He gets wasted. He has a blast. He's at the popular kids party before anybody else, just like partying. On top of that, the actor that plays Long Duk Dong, Gedi Watanabe, I never forgot him. And I followed his career. I still follow his career. He is in a special place in my heart because he took a role that could have been completely and utterly forgettable and even more offensive in retrospect, and he made this character an icon. The second example of racial stereotype type stuff is in Weird Science. If you haven't seen the movie, two teenage boys create a woman and bring her to life a la, you know, Dr. Frankenstein. They end up getting fake IDs and they go to this bar that's predominantly black. There are no suburban white boys in there. So they show up and, like, for sure the record screeches and stops. And Gary, Anthony Michael Hall's character, AMH, he drinks so much bourbon to fit in, and because he's so nervous, that he then becomes a character, his voice is affected, and he starts having mannerisms and characteristics of a black stereotype. When I listened to the Inside You podcast, he's a huge Richard Pryor fan. Richard Pryor has a character named Mudbone that he fashioned his own character for Weird Science after. It's an homage to all of the Richard Pryor things that he loved. Is it appropriate to affect a black person's voice for laughs? No. However, on the other side, he's sitting in a group of black men, like older black men. He is doing such an amazing job of, you know, and I'm not saying he's making fun of black people or a black character. He's in reverence to. And the joke is, if the joke is lost on you, the joke is he gets so wasted that he turns into a jive-ass cool black man. And everyone around him is totally fine with that. They're like, nope, yep, that, you know, that'll happen. All of the black actors in that scene, all of them play off of him so well. They sat down, they read the script, they tried out for the part, so they must have signed off on it in some way. But on top of it, it's hilarious. It's a hilarious scene. Then from there, we moved forward and learned that you probably shouldn't do that type of thing. Yeah. In both of those examples, in both 16 Candles and in Weird Science, yeah, they're out of bounds. They're out of pocket. They totally could have been a lot better with portraying any race besides the white race. And that is still true today, 100%. But because of those two, I was exposed to, as someone that was surrounded by white people in Wyoming growing up, I was tripping over them. It was so nice to see it in 16 Candles instance that there's this amazing dude. His name is Long Duk Dong. He goes hard. He wasn't cool because he was a stereotype. He wasn't funny because he was a stereotype. He was funny because he just went for it. He lived the teenage dream for one night. And in the case of Weird Science, yeah, Lisa takes him to a predominantly black bar, and they actually end up blending in and having a great time. For me, I saw that if you switch it up, do something different, and get out of your little homogenized white bread bullshit, you'll have a great time. That was the message I got out of that. I am not in any way saying that it's okay. If it offends you, it offends you, and that's okay too. When I saw it at the time, I saw that as opposed to that. And as far as all the questionable moments with females in all of the movies, there are so many relatable instances in those movies because back then, back when I was growing up, consent wasn't a thing. Consent wasn't a word. I didn't learn the word consent until I was in my mid-30s. Consent for us back then was being in close proximity to someone. If you were within arm's reach of someone, you were pretty much giving them your consent. That's how it was back then. I didn't know you could say no. I had no idea you could say no. I would just dip out and find a way to leave. I didn't realize you could be like, fuck off, I don't want to do that. So it took me a while to grow into this progressive way of being. It took me a while to learn how to articulate my feelings, to be like, okay, I feel like this upsets me because this and this. We never got to do that back in the day. There's several instances of when a woman has been taken advantage of through us looking back, through me seeing it for the first time. It was just commonplace. There are many examples within John Hughes movies of a very dicey ideal of what is okay with a woman. I will just say that in the instances that stand out the most, if you watch them and you watch what the characters don't do instead of what they do do, that's more what I took away from it. Farmer Ted, or the geek, or Anthony Michael Hall in 16 Candles, is privy to a drunken girl giving her, like, as a trade for Samantha's number, the lead character, Molly Ringwald. He doesn't do anything to her. It's implied that they both just fell asleep. They're both drinking. That was so endearing that that happened. They could have written a scene where they were awkwardly hooking up in the car. He has his first real sexual experience. They could have taken it in so many different directions, but they didn't. The bottom line was he's not really ready for stuff like that. Like, he wants the prestige, but he's not really ready for something like that. Watch that movie again and look at what they don't do. Plus, also, side note, Jake Ryan, the hot heartthrob, swoon-worthy jock guy, his whole MO through the whole movie is to find someone that loves him for him and doesn't use him for his money or his popularity or his car or his looks or whatever. That right there, no one talks about. That was one of the main things, too, that I think really inspired me was that, oh, there is someone out there. There might be someone out there. There's possibly someone out there that does want real love, that doesn't just want a party favor, that'll say yes to anything. And nobody really talks about that. So I just wanted to point that out. It's a very bold character choice. And then in the case of Weird Science, I'm gonna be honest, the two characters, Gary and Wyatt, like I said, they make a woman played by Kelly LeBrock. Kelly LeBrock was like one of my sexual awakenings. Drop dead gorgeous, but it wasn't really that. It was more that for the first time in my life, I saw a female character that was unapologetic, rebellious, confident, classy, sexy, fun, mature, balanced. Like, she was all of those things and hot. But the hot was kind of like an exclamation mark at the end of all those other things. I had never seen a lead character that was lusted after by everyone that was all of those things. That did me a great service, both in being like, ladies are gorgeous, and also in seeing that she was the one that everyone wanted, and those were her qualities. She's kind, she's brilliant, she's funny. Those were the qualities that they put into their magical stew that made this magical, wonderful, perfect woman. Arguably, making a woman out of a Barbie and like some 80s computer software, probably not the most progressive, forward feminist thing, but who they made is pretty feminist, if you ask me. I haven't really touched on Ferris Bueller's Day Off very much because that one I think is the least offensive with everything. There are touches and moments where you're like, that's not right. All but none representation. It's just a bunch of white people doing white people shit. But I will say that as far as Ferris Bueller's Day Off is concerned, he was smart and he didn't just take the bullshit. And Mr. Rooney was a fucking basket case, the principal that chases him around and, just has a rough time of things because he's just a psychopath. That satire saying, hey, the administrator that's in charge of all these children is probably the craziest person, did my heart good because there are so many educators and so many teachers out there that just really are not. They're there for the paycheck. They're there to assert their dominance. Just like certain police officers or, you know, they're there to be like, well, I was bullied, so now it's your turn, bitch. To see in Ferris Bueller's Day Off totally get it over on him the whole movie was probably the biggest takeaway for me. Plus the soundtrack kicks ass. Yeah. The relationship between Sloane and Ferris is really cool too. The scene where Ferris and Sloane are talking about the future and he says, do you want to get married? I'm not getting married. That did my heart good because back then her response ought to have been, oh my God, yeah, that'd be great. Let's get married today. There's no way. There's no way a 17 or 16 or however old Sloane is supposed to be, played by Mia Sara, another one that's just, you know, I love that they put that in there. I love that was her response. It was like, bitch, I'm not gonna marry you. Like, and I love that they talked about mental health and that Cameron was not okay. He was not okay. And he freaks out and has this really strong reaction, but embraces it because he knows that's the only way out of all of his neuroses. So it's like he has this whole, like, he has a breakthrough. He has a mental health breakthrough. Never seen that before. Those are my top three. Like I said, I could go on and on and on about John Hughes, about his movies, about all of them. I could do a video each, but I just wanted to flesh out and to let everybody understand what it was like back then, that these movies were the progressive thing. And for me personally, because I will always watch those movies, I've passed them on to my own kids. My oldest daughter loves the three that I mentioned. She's not big on 16 Candles or Pretty in Pink. She didn't vibe to those ones, which, fair enough. I don't think we would have as many celebrated, highly stylized, realistic, intelligent dialogue, pulling a laugh and then pulling a cry, you know, alternately stylized directors. I don't think we would have as many as we do now if it weren't for John Hughes. He was a pioneer. He was genre-defying. No one knew what to do with his movies, I'm sure, because it was like they were hilarious. They were talking about trauma. They were, there was so much going on. I think that's why they still have stood the test of time. And even though, yeah, there is some gnarly shit in there, that it's okay, though. Like, if you laugh, it's okay. If you laugh at that stuff, it's intended to make you laugh. It doesn't make you not progressive. It doesn't make you, you know, like a horrible person. It just makes you have a sense of humor. Inspiring within you, laughing at stereotypes. They're stereotypes for a reason. Laughing at a fumbled sexual situation, that's funny. We all can relate to that. That doesn't mean that you have gone back to the dark ages and need to be scolded and canceled. You are able to see life through a scope of a different time and place. And that's powerful. It's a powerful place to be, because then you can look around in our current times and go, wow, we've come a long way. You could even do that as you're watching movies from a bygone era. You could just be like, wow, I'm so glad that we've come so far past that, as something cringy happens, as something offensive happens. Call it out. John Hughes was a visionary, and he was a big deal. He still is to me. He will always be to me. Hopefully you can watch it guilt-free, and it's like a fun new experience for you. If you've seen them before, rewatch them. I guarantee you, you will re-remember why they were so great. Here's to John Hughes, who I think he really was a true collaborator, and I think he really did care for all of his actors. Shout out to all of his amazing actors that brought these wonderful stories to life, like so vividly, so iconically, so memorably. Thank you for giving me all the gifts that you gave me when I watched your movies, back then and now. And thank you for inspiring a new generation, as you do. And so that's it for now. Hope you enjoyed this one. I hope you guys are all very healthy and happy. I hope your holiday season is going swimmingly. I personally am not a big fan of the holidays. I don't think we need a designated day of thankfulness or peace or love. I do it all the time, all the damn day. So I don't know. I think we all have gotten really far away from what holidays are supposed to be. I mean, look at Black Friday. It's not an accident that the Black Plague and Black Friday have a similar vibe. Like, it's bad news. But if you went and you believe in that kind of thing and you're all about it, I hope you found some good deals. So that's it for now. Like, subscribe, share, notification-y, notification-er, and I'll speak to you guys soon. Have a good one.